of Revelation. Amen. And we're wrapping up our series on Revelation tonight. This is it. And I want to let you know that, yeah, we'll be starting our series on Sunday nights. I don't know if we'll do it this week or not, but I'll let you know some kind of way on occult exposure coming up. But we're also working on the book of Romans. Amen. So let's go to Revelation chapter 20. And let's just go ahead and read from verse 1, but we're not going to recover everything that we did. It says in verse 1, I saw an angel come down from heaven. If you don't have a Bible, if you don't have a King James Bible, we have some on that table back there, I think. No? Everybody grab one? All right, do we have any back there? Does anybody need a Bible? If you need a Bible, raise your hand. All right, everybody's good? Okay. Anybody need a Bible? No? Okay, cool. All right. I saw an angel come down. This is verse 1 of Revelation 20. I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. Now, last week I made a delineation between the fact that there was a star that fell from heaven in chapter 9 who had a key to the bottomless pit. When he opened it, the demon spirits and fallen angels came out. They were reserved for a final day of judgment that was coming. We're not going to talk about how those angels got trapped down there. We'll talk about that again sometime. But now this is different. This is an angel that's coming down from heaven. He has a key. And whereas the first time angels were released, this time a fallen angel, the fallen angel, will be bound up. And that's what it says in verse 2. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. Now, you think about the adjectives that are used right here. First off, he's called a dragon, but also he's called the old serpent. And so there's definitely a reference to the fact now we're at the end of the book and we're at the end of the plan. We're at the end of the age, if you will. And yet the reference goes all the way back to the garden incident. You know, I was just writing today and I think I'm probably getting ahead of myself. But I was thinking about the fact that there's 66 books in the Bible. And that the first two chapters talk about a world that was created by God that had no sin in it. When God finished his work of creation, he looked at everything that he created and he said, it is good. And the word of God said, he rested. I was reading something today and I thought it was so profound, and I probably shouldn't say it because I was thinking about maybe mentioning it Sunday, that as soon as Adam and Eve fell, God's rest was interrupted. God's Sabbath rest was interrupted because creation was a completed work, and then now all of a sudden mankind has fallen into sin, and now God begins to work the plan of redemption. And what I want you to know, there's two chapters in the Bible. People always say, oh preacher, you talk too much about sin. Oh preacher, you talk too much about the blood. You talk too much about the cross. No, you can't, because see, there's two chapters in the Bible that don't include it. The entirety of the rest of the Bible. Listen, I'm going to show you how much it is. It's this much right here. This much doesn't have sin in it. This much has sin in it. This is the plan of God. The entire narrative of the scripture is all about God's redemption plan, his work in the midst of humanity, as he is moving his plan forward to save those that are born of Adam, to save those that are born into sin. God has a plan, amen? And I've said it many times, he's not going to deter from it. It's one plan and one plan only, and it requires faith in that plan in order for you to be made right in the eyes of God. And so in this passage of scripture, though, the point I wanted to make was, is that he says that old serpent. So from the beginning, and now even all the way to the end, there's been this epic battle that's been raging in the heavenly realm. And now for this 1,000 years, it says in Satan, it bound him. This angel came down with a key and a chain and bound him for 1,000 years. We talked about that last week, about the millennial reign of Christ. He cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more. He's been a master at deception. You got to understand that. The word deceive means to cause one to get off the path, to deviate from the pathway. He's been a master at that. We haven't given him the credit that he's due, because he studies the human race. He studies people's intellect. He knows their motions, and he watches from afar, and he knows what it is that triggers them, and he knows how he can get them. And the whole time, the Word of God says, be sober, because your adversary, the devil, he roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. The Word of God is cautioning us to be sober-minded, to be aware that the enemy of your soul is on the prowl, and that he wants to destroy you. And everything within him, he wants to take you out. He wants to destroy you, and you need to understand that. That's why we talk about this. If anybody's ever lived any kind of a life of sin, that shouldn't be too hard to find a sinner, right? Right? If you've ever lived any kind of a life of sin, then you know what I'm talking about. Yes. Destruction. It will destroy you. Yes. It goes on to say right here, and it says, 1,000 years shall be fulfilled, and after that he must be loosed a little season. Now we talked about that too. Why does he need to be loosed? We talked about the fact that after the rapture of the church, it doesn't matter to me when you think the rapture is going to take place, there's going to be a rapture. And that's called a resurrection. It's going to be the resurrection of those that have died in Christ. What does that mean? It means, we're going to get to it in a second, your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You heard the gospel of Jesus Christ and you responded through faith. And when you did, the Holy Spirit made your heart his home. And so when that last day comes and the last trumpet sounds, the Bible says that those who are alive and remain, that we will not precede them who have fallen asleep. And the terminology describes those who have died in Christ. That they will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will go to meet them in the air. And there we shall be with the Lord forevermore. That's part of the first resurrection. See, Jesus was the first fruits of the resurrection. You understand that? He was the first one to resurrect from the dead. Death had no right to hold him down. Amen. Amen? There was no sin in him. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, the Word of God says in Hebrews 2:14 that he became us. Because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he took part of the same. And he became flesh, not sinful flesh. He took on the likeness of sinful flesh, meaning he became a human being. But he did not become a sinful human being. He was born of the Father, born of a virgin. There was no sin in him. And he lived his life to perfection. And when he laid that perfect life as a sacrifice, sin had no right to hold him down. And that's, the resurrection was inevitable. And the good news is that he's the resurrection and the life. And now that we've placed our faith in him, we also will resurrect from the dead. So he was the first fruit of the resurrection, but there's going to be a resurrection of those that are in Christ, and that word is synonymous with the rapture. Does that make sense? The rapture, resurrection. You can use those two words interchangeably. Not the resurrection of Jesus, the resurrection of the saints. Amen? There's also going to be another waking from the dead, and we'll talk about that here in a moment. But it goes on to say right here, well, what I was trying to say is, why would he be loosed for a season? And the truth is, the matter is that whenever you and I are resurrected from the dead, we're going to receive a glorified body like our Savior. The Word of God says, we're going to receive a glorified body. Things are going to be different for us. We're no longer going to be part of this fallen nature. You know, right now, whenever you put your faith in Christ and you learn how to keep your faith in Christ, your relationship to the sinful nature that you received from Adam, you understand that that's what drives you to sin? Yeah. That when you were born of Adam, there's a root of sin in you, and that it wants to compel you to go towards things that you're not supposed to go towards? The normal relationship in Christianity between the new child of God and sin is supposed to be that relationship is severed, and that it's lying dormant. Like it's not supposed to be active in ruling and reigning your life.
Right.
You know, you can pick your poison. I don't know what it is that keeps drawing you back. For some people it's alcohol, for some people it's drugs, for some people it's lust. It could be a lot of different things. You aren't gonna go to an addiction counselor and get set free.
That's right.
They can try to send President Clinton to an addiction counselor all they want to. The fact of the matter is that if he don't get Jesus in his heart, he ain't never going to be free.
That's right.
You're not going to send somebody to an addiction counselor to get free from alcohol or drugs.
That's right.
Oh, they may stay sober. You might be celibate, but you aren't going to be free.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now that there's freedom in Christ.
That's right.
The Lord will set the captive free.
Amen.
Amen. And so anyway, what we're talking about though is that he has to be loose. So when we get raptured out, resurrection, we receive a glorified body. At that point, hallelujah, then the sinful nature is eradicated. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? That right now it's still, even if you get saved, it's still in there.
Right.
And sometimes you won't like it, but it will try to flare up and cause you to go in a direction you're not supposed to go.
Amen.
Well, I thought that stuff was done. Yeah, well, that's what you thought, but that's why they call him the deceiver.
That's why he
does what he does. That's why he's good at what he does. He's been watching people and he knows how to get them off path. Mm-hmm. But one day when you receive your glorified body, that sinful nature will no longer be in you. But then there's some people that were left behind who made it through, who still have physical bodies, and they will procreate. And they will still have a sinful nature on the inside of them, but there's going to be a transition that takes place where the Spirit now that's ruling and reigning, because Jesus will rule and reign on a throne in Jerusalem for 1,000 years. And for that 1,000 years, the Spirit that's moving in the air, if you will, if you permit me to say it like that, that's what it says. It says the prince of the power of the air, Ephesians 2:2. And the Spirit, he's the Spirit that works in the children of disobedience.
Yes.
And so right now, the prevalent spirit in the air for the majority of the world is the spirit of Antichrist. God, Jesus said, don't love the world or the things of the world. And so, once again, right now, the prevalent spirit that's driving mankind in a certain direction is the spirit of Antichrist. But during the millennial reign of Christ, the prevalent spirit that it will be driving humanity will be the Holy Spirit. And we talked about that, where we said that, you know what, a wolf will lie with a lamb, a leopard with a goat, and a child will be able to put their hand on the viper's hole and not be hurt. Because the knowledge of the Lord will be in the land. But yet still, people are going to have a sinful nature.
Yes.
And after that 1,000 years, he'll be loosed. And I read it today, well, I'm sure we'll get to it, that the people that will be deceived will be more than the sands of the sea. Now, that just hit me for the first time. I don't think I ever really took note of that before. That still, even though all of that time for 1,000 years, Jesus was ruling and reigning from Jerusalem, and the Holy Spirit was the prevalent spirit moving upon humanity's heart, when Satan is loosed for a short period of time, the people that will be deceived will be counted more, the multitude, more than sand. And so it just goes to show you that this is, I mean, whether you believe it or not, I'm telling you what the Word of God says, I believe it. Amen. So then it goes on to say this, verse 4. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Now, we did a big old study on the mark of the beast. Y'all remember that? I mean, I had pictures trying to show you different things that it could possibly be. I mean, I feel like with all my heart, when you get the mark of the beast, that you're going to actually have to pledge allegiance to Satan. And when you do that in some way, I don't know if it's because when you do it that the Lord gives you a reprobate mind, because the Word of God talks about that, or if it's a mixture between that and also some kind of hoodoo that they do on the inside of you, but you won't repent. You're not going to, there's no coming back.
Right.
Once you got that, and listen, people done a whole lot worse than just getting a chip in their hand before. So you know it has something to do with whether it's the Word of God said it, so don't do it, or whatever the case, but there's no coming back once you do that. Don't think it'd be easy. I'm telling you right now, if you see your family starving and you're still here, don't think that you all macho and you're gonna take your stand now. Half the time we have a hard time taking a stand today for what's right. And you think we're going to take a stand whenever for that at least 3.5 years? The Antichrist himself, personification of the devil, is going to be ruling and reigning upon the earth? I'm telling you, it's going to be rough for people that are here. But nevertheless, there's going to be people who will refuse. Amen?
Yeah.
And they will give their life for the kingdom.
Right.
Just as Jesus gave his life for them, they will give their life for the kingdom. And at this point, This is after the Battle of Armageddon. When these people are this is a resurrection for them too, but they're part of the first resurrection. Amen? So you had a rapture. Let's just say a pre-trib rapture. You had a pre-trib rapture, which initiated and started the tribulation. And when the tribulation started, people began to have to give their life for the kingdom. So now their souls are under the altar. Remember we talked about that? I think it was seal number 5. Their souls are under the altar. And now they're, but they're not reunited with their body because the rapture's already taken place. But at the end of the Battle of Armageddon, these people that gave their life for the kingdom, who did not worship the beast, who did not take the mark, they also will be resurrected, and they also will rule and reign with Jesus for 1,000 years. Hallelujah. And so it goes on to say, though, that he saw thrones and they that sat on them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them. And it goes on to say right here at the end of that verse, after that semicolon, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Now, there's a common theme. Let's just go ahead and read all the way down to verse 6. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Talking about those that died after the battle, during the tribulation, are part of the first resurrection that also went on. Now, I can see where post-trib people, remember how we talked about we would try to point out whenever there was a pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib. I can see where post-trib people would use this as one of their scriptures. Because this resurrection, and it says this is the first resurrection, takes place after the Battle of Armageddon. Okay, does that make sense what I'm trying to tell you? All right, I hope so. On such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now, this is where I'm probably going to get a little bit deep for a second, but it was, for me, it was revelation today. And one of the things that I want to tell you is that when I talk about timelines and I draw you maps, all of that is part of a preparation to prepare your mind to become more familiarized with the scripture, so that as you're reading the scripture, you also are being able to make connections and to see various things taking place. I put this slide up here, and that you can't see all the words because I made it too big, but in the New Testament, there's a thought that believers will rule and reign, a recurring theme in the age to come. And so it calls them, if you'll see right there, it says in verse 6, that they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him. Now, the word reign is descriptive of a king reigning, right? And so let's go back to Revelation 5. If you want to turn with me to Revelation 5, verses 9 and 10. Revelation 5, verse 9. And they sung a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. Well, what does that mean? I mean, you're worthy to open the seals. He's the only one that was worthy, by the way. Why? Because you redeemed us. What does that mean? You purchased us. Purchased us. How? Yes. Through the blood.
Yes.
His blood was shed and he purchased us. From where? Where did he purchase us from? From every tongue, kindred, and nation. See, it's always God's plan after the flood that mankind would spread across the globe and remultiply and populate. Because God is about creating an eternal family during this temporary time frame known as human history. Amen? And so what it says, though, is that you've redeemed us through your blood. And then it says this in verse 10, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Then there's also a passage of scripture in 1 Peter chapter 2, starting in verse 9. It says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now, I got to tell you, in the Revelation passage we're talking about a king priest, all right? But that's at the end of the age, when you actually receive your reward. So the Word of God is teaching that we as believers will one day rule and reign with Christ. Now this, it got good for me today. I hope that you may not get excited about it like I did, but I get really excited when I see little things that I never saw before. But just hold on a second. So there's coming a day, according to the Word of God, because you received through faith God's eternal plan, and the Holy Ghost came to live on the inside of your heart, and you held on to Jesus. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Hold on to Jesus. No matter what you're going through. The devil wants to beat you up, and he wants to lie to you, and he wants to tell you that you're unworthy and that you've messed up way too bad. He's a liar and the father of lies. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus died on the cross and shed his sinless blood to set you free from bondage and to remove the cloud of guilt that's been hovering over your life. God speaks a word to you. You're righteous. Not because of your actions, but because of his action.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Keep your faith in him. Hold on to Jesus.
But
in the end, you're going to be rewarded with being able to be a king priest. But right now, it says right here in 1 Peter chapter 2 that this is for the here and now. You're a holy nation. You're a chosen nation of peculiar people. Come on. A royal priesthood. Royal, kingly, royalty. Priesthood. There it is again. King priest. Now, I started thinking, see, when I think of king priest, what is the first name that comes to your mind?
David.
David. David. Yeah. Well, he functioned as a priest one time, but really and truly, for the most part, the kings weren't priests.
Jesus
is a king priest, right?
Right?
But there was one more in the Bible. Anybody want to take a stab at it?
Melchizedek.
That's right. Melchizedek. Hang around. We'll teach you about it. Well, let's go ahead and learn a little bit. Hebrews chapter 7. Because, see, for me, this was so good. And I wondered why all them times I kept going back to Melchizedek. Like, why I got to learn that stuff? Man, I'm telling you, it has something to do with the end of the reward.
Yeah.
So in Hebrews chapter 7, we're just going to go ahead and read through some of this passage of scripture, and I think that I'm just going to try to tie it all together there in a second. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 1. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem. Do y'all know where Salem is?
At Jerusalem.
That's ancient Jerusalem.
Ancient.
We always draw our little map, or at least I try to draw the map. Jerusalem was down here. It used to be called Salem. How do you say peace in Hebrew?
Shalom.
So like Salem. Salam. Shalom. That's what the word. So the word means peace. Mm-hmm. All right. And so it says right here, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the most. Oh, he was a king priest. See there? King of Salem, priest of the most high God, who met Abraham. That's what that picture is supposed to be right there. That's supposed to be Melchizedek right here. Meeting Abraham on the battlefield, and what he's got wine and bread. He's meeting Abraham after Abraham and 318 of his servants destroyed those five kings that had come together, and he's offering him, this is interesting too, he's offering him communion, it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
Communion. He's offering Abraham communion. Communion is representative of peace between man and God. The king of Sodom offers him money for souls.
Ooh,
isn't that something?
Mm-hmm.
The king of the wickedness offers him money for souls. I want the souls of the men. Melchizedek, priest of God Most High, offers communion on the battlefield.
Wow.
We're in the midst of a battlefield of life, folks. And there's two kings that are coming.
That's right.
The king or the prince of this world that Jesus called him. And he wants to offer you worldly things, and he wants your soul.
Yes.
And the king named Jesus, lowly and riding on a donkey, but he's offering communion. Amen? All right, so Melchizedek, king of Most High, returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. Talking about Abraham. He blessed Abraham. To whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all. Did you realize that that's the first time in the Bible that we learn about the tithe?
That was way over there in Genesis.
Tithe. Anybody know what that means?
A tenth.
The word tithe means a tenth. The first time anybody ever paid a tithe was Abraham paid a tithe to this king priest named Melchizedek. This is long before there was ever an Israel. This was long before there was ever a law. So you can't say that paying tithes went out with the law. Heresy. It's right here in the scripture. It's scriptural to pay your tithes.
Yes.
Amen? Now, I'm not trying to twist anybody's arm. I'm just telling you what the Word of God says. Amen? Uh-huh. All right. Does it feel like I'm twisting your arm? Yeah? Okay, sorry. Hold on to your billfold. No, that's not true. No, really, my heart is that people would want to give. Amen? Because you don't want to make somebody be a give begrudgingly. Amen? All right. We need to hurry up. Verse 2. To whom Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness. We're talking about Melchizedek now. His name is king of righteousness. And after that, also king of Salem, which is king of peace. So he's a king priest. Amen? And then I wanted to just go ahead and skip down to verse... we probably ought to not skip. Let's just read. Verse 3. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. Now, you can read a whole lot of different people's opinions on this. Some people will tell you that it was an angel. Some people will tell you that it was actually Noah's son, Shem. We don't know. The reference, it's not even saying that he definitely didn't have a mother and father, but that definitely the Bible has no record of it. The point is, though, is that because there's no record of it, there's no chronology of it, there's no way to prove it, the point that the author's making is that he is an eternal priest king of an eternal priest kinghood. Amen? King priesthood. And so... it goes on to say, now consider, verse 4, how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils. And verily, they that are of the sons of Levi, who received the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. Now let's just slow down a second, because I want to kind of break this down a little bit. So we got Abraham... is what we're talking about during the time frame of Melchizedek. Abraham had one son named Isaac. Isaac had a son named Jacob, right? And Jacob had a wife named Leah. Does anybody remember who their third son was?
Judah.
Judah was number 4.
Levi?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Levi.
Who said that? Number 3 was Levi. Number 4 was Judah. From Levi come the priests.
Yes.
Abraham was about 2000 BC. Moses was about 1440 BC. So what are we looking at here? Somewhere around 600 years, 550 years, something like that, 500 years. So whenever they leave the Exodus, what ends up happening is that the sons of Levi, which actually Moses, Miriam, his sister, and Aaron were from where?
From Levi.
They were from Levi. And the high priest had to come from who? Aaron. The Aaronic priesthood. So I'm trying to make a point here. 2000 BC, Abraham, Jacob's son, Levi, from him come the tribes. Now we're talking 500 years of people procreating that are under the tribe of Levi. Remember I taught you that a while back out of 1 Chronicles chapter 24 whenever we preached on John the Baptist's daddy, how they were in certain courses, because now we're talking another 1,000 years later when we get to King David, which was 1,000 BC or at least another 500 years later, where he starts breaking them down into courses to where they minister inside of the temple. Right? And so what I want you to see is that if you can envision in your mind from Levi, from the tribe of Levi, you have all of these different people that are being born. They could be off, and so all this time you have all these people from Levi, but you just have within here the main characters in this time frame, Aaron and Moses. But how many other people were there from Levi? Does that make sense at this time, 500 years later? Multiple children, multiple offspring. But now if we just focus, could you imagine that just from these, all of the people that would be born from Levi? You understand what I'm trying to say? The multitude upon multitude to the point where whenever they were at John the Baptist's father was from there, but also his mother came from the sons of Aaron. You understand what I'm saying? Like, in other words, if you did your family tree back and you tried to start mapping out who the Abears were or who the Delonies were, all of these hundreds and hundreds of people, but we're talking thousands of years, so they got all of these people. The difference between Levi was that it was a temporary priesthood. Does that make sense? So what it says right here is talking about the difference between Melchizedek, and it's talking about the difference between Levi. And it says Levi, who has the office to receive tithes from the people. Does that make sense? He's a priest. All of the people, the tribe of Levi. Listen, Paul's talking. This is 1000 B.C. I'm probably confusing y'all. This is 1000 B.C. This book was written, this letter we're reading, in A.D. 65. So Paul's talking. Look at all this time frame, all this going backwards, all this information that's taking place. And he's saying that Levi paid tithes to Melchizedek while he was in Abraham's loins. So what I'm trying to say is this. This is Abraham. This is Melchizedek. Levi is somewhere up in here in his loins. He's not even a thought. Levi's not even going to be born for another probably 50 years. But then he's not even just talking about Levi specifically as much as he's talking about the priesthood of Levi, which takes place thousands of years later.
Yeah.
And so he's saying that Levi was in Abraham at this point in time. And so now Abraham, Levi's paying tithes to Melchizedek. The point is that this was a superior priesthood. You get the point. That's what the author to Hebrews is, the point he's trying to make. This was a superior priesthood. It was a king priesthood. And it goes on to say in this passage of Scripture, it says, verse 6, but he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham and blessed him that had the promises. In other words, Melchizedek's descent did not come from Levi. Yet he received tithes. Alright, instead. And Levi wasn't getting the tithe. He was getting the tithe. And then look what it says in verse 7. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. That means that, in other words, Melchizedek's priesthood was greater than the priesthood of Levi. And here men that die receive tithes from them. From there he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. And as I may so say, Levi also who received if tithes, pays tithes in Abraham. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Then it goes on to talk about the imperfection of the Levitical priesthood, which is a fancy word to talk about the Levi priesthood. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? In other words, if God had this big old plan that through Levi was going to come all of the priests, and that specifically from not only from Levi, but over here during 500 years later, during the time frame of Moses, God was going to split it off even more so and say that the high priest has to come from Aaron. So if the law was perfect, and if this Levitical priesthood was perfect, then why would God in his word, and let me just tell you, I'm not going to turn there, Psalm 110, during the time frame of King David, 1000 B.C. So he knew about Abraham, he knew about Melchizedek when the Holy Spirit told him to write it, he knew about Levi, and all of a sudden out of nowhere, King David, as he's writing a psalm, the Holy Ghost tells him, you will be forever a priest after the order of Melchizedek. Bam! Sign down on the dotted line, put down on the paper for all of Israel to see, for all of them to be aware, something completely new, some completely new mindset, some completely new thought. Well, what does he mean after the order of Melchizedek? He's a king priest. And then it goes on to say right here, it says in verse 12, for the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. For he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. Look at this. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spoke nothing concerning priesthood. See, I'm already getting excited. I know that I can't get y'all excited about this because I'm not doing a good enough job of explaining. But what I want you to see is this, is that the kingly tribe was Judah. The priestly tribe was Levi. The kings weren't priests and the priests weren't kings. But over here, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, God says, you will be a priest forever, eternally, after the order of Melchizedek. Who is you? He was talking about Messiah. Who's Messiah? The anointed one. Who was that? Jesus. His name is Jesus, the Christ, the one that showed up. And he came from Judah, the kingly tribe. All right? Now, I said all that to say this. This is a temporary. I never saw this connection before. I know I'm getting excited, but I never saw this connection before. This is a temporary priesthood.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
That started off with Levi, and then it went to Aaron, yes, and filtering down multitudes upon multitudes of temporary priests.
Wow.
But hallelujah in Christ, the one who came from the order of Melchizedek, the king priest. The word of God says that you who were born again of him, hallelujah, in that day when you're resurrected from the dead, there's going to be a multitude upon a multitude of eternal king priests that come from the order, hallelujah, of what God's plan was. I don't know about you, but that stuff gets me excited. I could have never seen that in a million years if I didn't know who Levi was, if I didn't know who Judah was, if I didn't know who Melchizedek was. And all of a sudden, I'm just sitting there in my car today, and bam, the Lord hit me with it. It's like, man, to me, I get excited about that. Because why do you get so excited, preacher? Because the word of God is real. And God's putting it in there, and he's asking his people to dig it out and to believe that it's there and to study it.
Yes.
Like it's real, like it's really his communication.
Yes.
Man, I was trying to share with somebody the other day. I'm like, dude, you don't believe that the word of God is the word of God. We got problems.
Sorry.
You ain't gonna like my preaching. Why in the world would you sit there and try to find out what the original Greek meaning of a word was if you didn't think that God actually placed it inside the heart of the man to write it down to begin with? Why would you worry about whether or not it was a noun or a verb to begin with if you didn't believe it was the literal word of God? That's why I do that. You thought I just like doing English lessons? No. It's the word of God.
That's right.
And we want to find the original meaning of it. We don't want to sit here and teach somebody else's book. We want to teach his book. Amen? All right, let's go back to Revelation. We need to hurry. All right, so then it goes on to say that we're going to worship. We're going to rule and reign with him. Look at verse 8. That's just, I want to show you that verse. It says, talking about Satan will be loosed and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth. This is verse 9 of chapter 20. And compassed the camp of the saints about in the beloved city. Then it says in verse 10, and the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Hallelujah. There's coming a day when the devil will no longer deceive. He will no longer cause people to go off the path of God. God will win. He's already won. It's just a matter of time now.
Yes.
And like I said earlier, I said the prevalent spirit moving on the earth today and driving the majority of the world is the spirit of Antichrist. But to those of us who are born again in the Lord, amen, the Holy Spirit living in our heart, if we'll allow him to rule and reign, the enemy of our soul does not have power over us.
Right.
And he goes on to say in verse 11, I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. You know, I went back to verse 6, where it says, blessed and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no more power. And I counted how many times the word death and dead was used, and it was 8 different times. And it's talking about the second death. See, the first death, descriptive of your first your body born of Adam that was born in sin. And there's going to come a day when you're going to breathe your last breath. And your eternal soul is going to go wherever it's going to go. If you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'm telling you what the Bible teaches, then your eternal soul will go to the second death. The second death is eternal separation from the presence of God and eternal torment. And I'm telling you, it's not a place that we want to be. Amen. And it goes on, and so it says it 8 different times, and it goes on to say that they stood there, and it was talking about these books. And it mentioned, I put this slide up there, the Lamb's Book of Life. I want you to know that there's a Lamb's Book of Life. And recorded in that book is every name of every human being that has ever believed according to the plan of God. Amen? And it says right here that, let's look at verse 12 a little closer. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. So there's multiple books. And it says, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. So there's a bunch of books, and it sounds like they have information about works in there. And then there's one book, and it's called the book of life. Now, I got to tell you something. The reason that that book of life is there is not because they're expecting anybody's name to be found in it. This is a resurrection of the dead. It's for a purpose. It's a point. Because your name's not in this book, we now go to this book to judge you according to your works. Now, what you got to understand is that you don't go to hell based upon your works, and you don't go to heaven based upon your works. You go to hell or heaven based upon your choice to place faith in Christ. But a person who has truly given their life to the Lord and the Holy Spirit lives in their heart, over the course of their life begins to show forth certain works, amen, that are representative of a believer in Christ. Whereas a person who does not give their life to Christ, their works that they have offered up repetitively show the nature and the kind of person that they are. And so based upon that, here's a picture of the great white throne judgment and all those books up there. And then there's another one, and we don't have time to go to it, of the judgment seat of Christ. There's two different judgments that the Bible speaks of. I already did a teaching on the judgment seat of Christ. At the judgment seat of Christ, Christians' works are judged, all right? It's not like you're being judged whether you're going to heaven or hell. You're being judged on what you did for the Lord, yes, during your time frame upon this earth. And I guess I went a little bit too fast right there, but some of those scriptures that we talked about that I had up there, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, it says that we are His creation, that essentially in Christ we're being created for good works that He preordained in advance. God's desire is that when we come to Christ, He's going to mold us, amen, and He's going to change us. He's going to put within us a heart and a desire to do works for Him. And so when you're a believer and you put your faith in Christ, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now you will offer up works that will be judged. And based upon that, let me just say this. There's two parables in the scriptures. One speaks of a reward based on the works of the Christian. It's the parable of the talents. Y'all remember that one? He gave to one. Mm-hmm. He gave to another one, what, 3? And another one, 5. And the one that had 3 doubled it. The one that had 5 doubled it. The one that had 1 was scared and he hid it in the ground. It said that the good man went on a long journey and he came back to settle accounts with his servants. That's Jesus going away for this time frame of the church age. And when he comes back, the one that had doubled the money, he said, well done. He said, "You well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in small things. Now be a ruler over many things." So during this time frame on earth, You and I are being entrusted with particular things. When he comes back to settle accounts, he wants to see whether or not we've been faithful in our work. So depending upon what we did in this temporary time frame known as earth is a direct reflection on what how we will be rewarded in the afterlife. Amen? Whereas there's another parable that says, it's talking about the unredeemed, and it says that they knew to do right. There was more light during that time frame. People that heard the gospel of Jesus Christ but rejected it will be judged at a higher level than those that were in the Old Testament before the law, because they had less light. God is just and he's merciful. And he's going to judge people based upon the amount that they knew. There's going to be varying levels of judgment. There's going to be varying levels of reward based upon that, those concepts in the scripture. I believe that. Amen. And so it goes on to say right here, we're about to wrap this up. It says, verse 13, and the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man, according to their works. So I just wanted to make that clear. I think I made that clear, right? When it says that people are being judged according to their works, it doesn't mean that you get into heaven based upon what you do. It means you get into heaven based upon faith in what he did. Amen? And that the work of the Holy Spirit in you is going to drive you towards good works. All right? And then it says, death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death, and whoever's name was not written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So I did this this slide real quick, and we'll end with this. There's a lot. Sometimes people have a hard time understanding this, but there's a lot of different words that are used for hell in the Old Testament. If you'll remember that, there's the words like death, hell, grave, Hades, Sheol. Have y'all ever read the Old Testament and seen all those words?
Yes.
Basically, what that's talking about is the place of departed souls. All right? So in other words, right in the Old Testament or even now, whenever you die, you go to the underworld or wherever that is, and your soul is waiting. Not now. Let me be careful. Now, the Apostle Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Praise
I got you punch drunk with all this information. Huh?
Praise
it's okay. Just hang tight. Are y'all getting squirmy on me? We're about to close. I'm sorry. So in the Old Testament, whenever you died, it was before Jesus died on the cross. And when it says death, hell, Hades, Sheol, it's descriptive of the place of departed souls. There was another place in the Old Testament before Jesus died on the cross called Abraham's bosom. So if you are paradise, so if you were a believer in the Old Testament sacrificial system, which pointed to the day when Jesus would come, then and you died, you went to the grave, Sheol, whatever. But down there's multiple compartments. And one of those compartments was Abraham's bosom or paradise. And if you were a believer, you went there. But the Word of God says that once Jesus went to the cross, that place isn't there anymore. And so now, whenever people die, they go to the torment side of hell, and they await their final judgment, which will be after the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ at the Great White Throne Judgment. Then there's this other place right here called Tartarus. I've taught y'all about that before. It's translated as hell in the New Testament, and it's where those fallen angels are bound up in chains of darkness. We're not going to get into all that. But the last thing, look at this graph, is that there's a place called Gehenna. And Gehenna is the lake of fire. And in the last death, hell, Hades, all those compartments are thrown into the lake of fire, along where the devil is, along where the false prophet and the beast are. And the reason why is because at that point in time, There's no longer going to be anybody that's going to be thrown into eternal judgment. There's no longer going to be anybody that's going to be going into Hades or grave or the Sheol or the death.